There's actually quite a few skills to master in the competent use of an astronomical telescope, but probably one of the ones that causes people most difficulty is actually learning to use just one eye. It's not too surprising that this can be a bit of a challenge, really. We're an organism designed to use two eyes and enjoy stereoscopic vision, so it's far from natural to us to be just using one eye and squinting into the eyepiece and that kind of thing. Now, if you are having difficulties with that use of the telescope, especially if you're a newbie, I'm going to show you a piece of equipment now that really gets around that completely and enables you to keep both eyes open, and that's a binocular eyepiece holder. So here it is then. This is the binocular eyepiece holder, sometimes called a bino viewer. You can see we've got an 1.25 inch eyepiece style nose piece on the front end there. Incidentally, that's threaded for filters, so you can screw a Barlow or put filters on the front of that. At the rear end here, we've got the eyepiece holders, suited for 1.25 inch eyepieces, obviously. This particular model is by Skywatcher, and it's got these rather nice compression ring eyepiece holders here with a full brass band, a genuine compression ring rather than just an anti-marring tape. Very nice because it actually centers up the eyepieces on it. The other thing I want you to see here as well is that it has two independent helical eyepiece focusers. So each one of these allows the eyepiece to move independently. Now obviously all I've got to do is stick a couple of eyepieces in it. One obvious downside with a bino viewer is that you need two eyepieces and they've got to be exactly matched. So if you've got a very expensive eyepiece collection, with any luck, we'll do very nicely supplying you with extra eyepieces. So good for us, bad for you. There we go. So we've got our two eyepieces in place now, and slip that into the eyepiece holder, and in principle, we're ready to go. Now, what is it that's so great about the binocular eyepiece holder? If you go onto forums and look at some of the approval ratings of this equipment, I think you might be quite surprised about what people actually say about it. They're saying things like, I see stuff with the bino viewer, I just can't see. I see more with the bino viewer than I've ever seen on with the telescope before. What's going on? Is this really true? Is it possible that they're actually seeing more information in the binocular viewer? We need to think about what's going on with the bino viewer, probably in a little bit more detail. A conventional binocular, of course, has prisms in it. No surprises there, I think. And the binocular viewer is no different. It also employs prisms. In fact, its design is a little more sophisticated than a conventional binocular, because instead of having two independent views being presented to the eye, we start out with one view, and then that's split into two using a prism system so that both eyes can see that one single view. And there are prisms inside the binocular viewer, and straight away this gives an indication of where some of the light is going and why you don't get out of the binocular viewer exactly what you put in. These prisms actually scatter some of the light. So the light beam that actually passes through these prisms, and there's, as I say, there's more than one of them in a complex form, some of the light actually goes sideways through the prism and is scattered. So instead of actually coming to your eye, it's lost inside the body of the binocular viewer. No big problem, but it's worthwhile bearing in mind that you get less out of the binocular than you put in. So how does that really pick up on this idea that people see more in the binocular viewer than they do with just using one eyepiece? How can that really be? If we actually get less out of the binocular viewer because of absorption by the prisms in it, and in fact the problem is sufficiently large that the binocular viewer will actually take about an inch off of the aperture of your telescope. So if you compare the brightness of the target with a single eyepiece and when you put the bino viewer in, typically a lot of people would say it takes about an inch off the aperture. It's one of the reasons why we would suggest you restrict the use of a bino viewer to telescopes of 3 inches or 75 mil and above, simply because very small telescopes probably can't afford to lose that inch of brightness. So it tends to work better on a larger aperture telescope. So let's go back to the main idea then. How can it be that we actually see more with the bino viewer? Okay, well, I'm going to give you a little demonstration, and it might help us home in on where this problem is. We're going to use this little model of Galileo's scope here, and if I present my eye to it and take a view of a target. Now, I've got a couple of choices about what I can do. I can cover this eye up by winking and concentrate on what's going on in the main scope. That's really not very comfortable. So as astronomers, we try to train ourselves to keep both eyes open all the time and to try to ignore anything else that I can see. Well, unless you're actually observing in pitch darkness, and even then, one eye has got an image, one eye has not. One eye is trying to range at infinity. If we catch a glimpse of any part of the superstructure of the telescope at all, and bearing in mind it's really close to my face, there's a tension there. One eye is ranging at infinity, the other eye is picking up nearby detail. So there's actually a tension between these two eyes. And whenever there's tension between your eye, an ancient part of the brain is going to be very slightly disturbed by that. You'll tend to see it in new people who have not used to using a telescope before. They'll look through the telescope and they'll start to see detail. If you've got a telescope, you may have seen this with family and friends. They'll see some detail and, oh yeah, the rings of Saturn, whatever. And almost immediately they'll take their eye away from the eyepiece. So instead of staying at the eyepiece, when they see something exciting, they'll look for it for a very brief period of time, and then all of a sudden they'll take their eye away from the eyepiece and then go back to it again. Why do they do that? What's happening? The nearest thing I can suggest to you that you might be familiar with this idea, is you're working at a desk and there's a sash cord blowing in the wind. You look at the sash cord and establish that indeed it's a sash cord blowing in the wind. You go back to your work again. It isn't a tiger creeping up on you, it's definitely a sash cord. The more you get engrossed in your work, the more likely it is you're going to look at that sash cord again. You're going to be distracted. And that's really what's going on when you use just one eye. You're actually being distracted. And the more you concentrate on the image, the more the ancient brain says, oh, hold on a minute, I don't like this, I've got something close to the face. Take a look at that and see what it is. With the bino viewer, both eyes are engaged. Because of this engagement of your complete visual system, you will spend longer at the eyepiece. If you spend longer at the eyepiece, it's easy to understand you're going to see more. It's as simple as that, really. So really, you can see that the power of the bino viewer is there's very little learning how to use it. You don't have to get used to using one eye. There's no kind of strategy to get used to because both eyes are engaged. It's what the human race has been doing for a million years. There's no getting into this idea. You're ready to go straight away with the bino viewer. The bino viewer is probably the best thing when you're showing people different targets. They will see exactly what you're seeing. But I do promise you, you will never see anything in a bino viewer that if you put one eyepiece in, you won't see it just as well. The reason why people report seeing so much more in a bino viewer is if you really run the clock, you'll find that most people will spend a lot longer at the eyepiece with a bino viewer because of that lack of distraction, that lack of contest between what one eye is doing and what the other eye is doing. I'm just going to bring a couple of features to your attention about the bino viewer that you need to be aware of. We can see it actually quite nicely on this telescope here. I want you to see where the focuser is actually positioned. So if we assume that this telescope is in focus with one eyepiece in this position, what's going to happen when we put the bino viewer in? I put the bino viewer in place. Well, obviously that's not going to be in focus now because the eyepieces are very significantly further away. So I'm going to have to drive the eyepiece holder tube further in to the telescope, towards the objective, to try to use up that 100 mil. Now, it could be on a scope like this, there isn't quite 100 mil there, so I'm not going to be able to easily get the bino viewer into focus. There are a couple of strategies you can employ to get the bino viewer into focus when you're using a refractor. One would be to do away with a big chunky 2-inch star diagonal like this. I can see something hitting the floor if I'm not careful. And switch to a much smaller star diagonal. One that's physically got less impact on the focus throw of the telescope, because you can see it's quite a bit smaller, and we introduce that into place now. And that might just give us enough. So that's one strategy you can employ, making sure that you get the bino viewer as close to the objective or the mirror of your telescope as you can. Another strategy works quite nicely, is to actually add a Barlow. Obviously, the problem of adding a Barlow is it's going to dramatically increase the focal length of your telescope, and you may want to back off your eyepieces because it might easily overpower the system if you've got a short focal length eyepiece. So when the Barlow goes in, you probably need to step the eyepiece back. We've got 9mm in here at the moment. Might be better off with something like a 20 if we don't want to get too much magnification. But another nice little trick you can do with a lot of modern Barlows, and sometimes you can buy these on their own, is to take the lens head off the Barlow and actually screw that directly to the nose piece, and that will increase the focal length of the telescope. But remember, when you use the Barlow, you also increase the amount of in-focus travel. So the margin of variation that the focal length of the telescope gives you to accommodate focusing is also doubled, or in this case, increased by a factor of 1.5. And again, that may give you enough focus throw or in focus movement to be able to get the image in focus. Now, obviously, other telescopes like Newtonian reflectors can obviously be a big problem when used with a Barlow, used with a binoviewer rather. So I tend to think of this product as being ideally suitable for use with refracting telescopes. Once you get used to bino viewing, it can be very hard to give it up. I find I really enjoy bino viewing, looking at planets and the moon and maybe the sun with a solar filter, but probably is less than ideal for nothing except the very brightest deep sky targets, simply because of that absorption problem I was telling you about, the tendency of the Barlow to use up some of the light being produced by your telescope, simply getting the prisms going caused by that dispersion effect. Anyway, that's it for bino viewers right now. Look forward to seeing you soon.